I'd like to be able to show you guys this video about cicadas, but probably tomorrow or Friday, because we are in a year of cicadas, right? If you go outside, like, at in the evening, whatever, it's, like, overwhelmingly loud.
Oh, yeah.
So, if you didn't realize, yeah, that's because of cicadas. So, I'd like to show you guys that video, so I'm hoping we can cover more than just 5-4 today, but we're starting already a little bit late, so we'll see how far we can go. What's up, Ethan? Yeah. When I, at the beginning of the summer, when I would drive home to Coshocton, as soon as we hit a certain point, because they migrate, they're now, they've left Coshocton, they've made it over to here. But when we would drive home, there'd be a point where I was like, what the heck is that noise? And I thought it was a chainsaw. Like, I thought somebody was cutting wood, and I rolled down my windows to, like, hear what it was. And, like, as soon as I rolled the windows, I was like, oh, it's cicadas. But I didn't realize because it had been so long, because they come either every 7 years or 11 years, or they're on different cycles to try to not meet up with each other. Is that what you were going to say?
Oh, I was going to say at lunch that there was a cicada thing, and one of my friends put it on the friend's shoulder.
Yeah, they freaked out probably.
No, they didn't freak out until somebody goes, there's a giant bug on your shoulder.
Yeah, my sister used to do that to me because my sister's 2.5 years older. So, yeah, you can mess with your friends. Yeah, my sister and brother both older. So, today we're talking about properties of rhombuses, rectangles, and squares. Now, why does this make sense in our progression of the chapter talking about polygons? What did we deal with yesterday? Parallelograms, right? And rhombuses, rectangles, and squares, what do they all have in common? They're parallelograms. So, the only other type that is not a parallelogram is what kind of quadrilateral? Well, only other type that has a specific name. Brian? Trapezoids and kites, right? So, up here, if you check out kind of our flow chart, if we drop down from quadrilateral, we could go left to kite and right to trapezoid. Now, wait, why is a rhombus a kite and a parallelogram? What makes the rhombus a kite and a parallelogram? What's one of the classifications of a kite? Like, what's one of the cool things that happens in a kite? Or how is it different? Calvin? We have adjacent congruent sides, like my two top sides there, my two bottom sides are congruent. What about the diagonals across the shape from point to point? How do the diagonals interact with each other? Ryan? Now you're trying too hard. Because kites can be any size, so we can manipulate the sizes all kinds of ways. Megan? They are perpendicular to each other. So if I know that in a kite, my diagonals are perpendicular, when I drop down to a rhombus, what do I know about a rhombus? The diagonals have to be perpendicular because a rhombus has all of the what am I trying to say? Yes, I'm getting stuck on classifications, but all of the qualifications that make it a kite and a parallelogram. So, just like that, a rectangle only has the parallelogram classifications. A square has all parallelogram classifications, or qualifications, and all of the kite. Because in a square, the diagonals do meet at 90 degrees, and it has all of that same relationship of the kite because the adjacent sides are congruent. Well, all of the sides are congruent, but that means that adjacent sides are congruent. So that's that little flow chart, I think, is pretty beneficial. And it's really simple. That doesn't give too much, like, to clog up your vision. So I love that flow chart for trying to classify. So,
excuse the interruption. Could I please have Aiden Mitchley to the office? Aiden?
In our key concept sections, we go over rhombus, rectangle, square. We all probably know the qualifications. I want my coffee, not my microphone. We all probably know the qualifications of these shapes, and we worked with them for a while. But one thing that we may not necessarily realize is here in Theorem 51, what could we say, like, what is this really telling me about the rhombus? And of course you can read it, but if you just look at the diagram with the angle numbers, what could we say about the diagonals of a rhombus? Yes, it says it in the theorem, but, yeah. No, actually, the lengths of the diagonals. So, like, AC will be shorter than BD. Because notice how it's like the long corners versus the short corners. So, not that they're congruent. Carmen? Yeah, so I would, if I was you, and you guys should all have highlighters, I would highlight diagonals, bisect, opposite angles. If your parallelogram is a rhombus, if, which one were you looking at? Oh, but that's for rectangles. Yeah, so be careful there. So, here, and then, so that's worth highlighting. In a rectangle, the diagonals, they don't bisect the angles, but they are congruent to each other. So, rhombuses, the diagonals bisect the angles. In a rectangle, the diagonals are congruent to each other. Because really, that creates similar triangles, or congruent triangles. Any questions on any of the key concepts up here? Anything that doesn't make sense? Yeah, I put those on there just as reminders for you guys so you can refer back to it just to check the rules. So, if we go look at this stained glass window, and you guys might have to draw a little bit in on your image because it prints out a little bit dark. It says, is EFGH a rhombus, rectangle, or square? So, EFGH is this shape. And it has a tick mark there and a tick mark there. We see a right angle up here. So I don't know if you can hear it or not, but when that's on, there's a buzz. The other. So listen right now. Ears may not be tuned. So this is like goes back to my whole like I DJ and whatever. My ears are really sensitive. And it gets worse just to explain things that I do so you guys aren't like, what the heck? Now you can definitely hear. So that is the white noise of electricity. What you're hearing is electricity. That's really weird because it's not grounded correctly. So what kind of shape can that be? What do we think? We know we have a right angle up here, which means that these are perpendicular to each other. We know, well, what does this symbol mean? Parallelogram, right? So we know it's a parallelogram. So we know that HE and GF are parallel, and HG and EF, that's sounds bad because all those letters sound the same. But we see those parallel sides. We see two congruent sides, but how are those sides congruent? Are they opposite sides or adjacent sides, Carmen?
So I was gonna say that I'm pretty sure it's a rhombus.
Okay. So you gotta explain it though.
Yeah.
Because it still kinda sounded like you got a question mark on it.
Oh.
I think it's a rhombus?
Yeah, okay. I'm pretty sure. And because since it's a parallelogram and we know that like HE is congruent to GF and EF is congruent to HG. And so that would then also mean that all
So wait, you said HE congruent to EF and then you said something after that.
HE is congruent to GF and
GF. How do you know that?
Because it's a parallelogram.
Ah, so even though it's not given to us in the problem, even though it's not shown to us, because we know... Ah, crap. Well, that little line should not be there. Because we know it's a parallelogram, if these two lines are parallel and these two lines are parallel, we know the distances between them have to be the same based off that relationship. So that's what allowed Carmen... make this statement, and then we could also make, I think you went on.
Then EF is congruent to GH.
Okay.
And so then, since HE is congruent to EF, that means all the sides are congruent.
Yeah, so, since HE, guys, this is good practice for your proofwriting. Since HE is congruent to EF, what property would allow us to make that jump? That they're all congruent to each other. It's one of the easy ones. So we've said, like, let's say we've said 1 is congruent to 2, 3 is congruent to 4, and since 1 is congruent to 3,
then, Ethan? 1 is congruent to 4.
Yeah, how? What property? Or what theorem? Substitution, right? So we could say by substitution, what am I spelling? By substitution, all four sides are congruent. Sweet. And we don't know anything about the interior angles of it, so we can't really go any further. Yeah, so we don't know that they're not, but do we have anything indicating that they are right angles? Or do I know any other angle that would let me solve for anything? The only angle notated is angle B, and it's a right angle. Michelle? Well, so that's kind of, in a rectangle, once all four sides are congruent, it becomes a square. So it's still a rectangle, so be careful saying how you said that, because it is still a rectangle, it just then gets classified as a square. Just like a rhombus is a parallelogram, just rhombus is more specific. Square is more specific. Make sense? Okay. Other questions? Why this is a rhombus? So, what are the measures of the numbered angles in rhombus ABCD? So it's nice that it tells us that it is a rhombus because we can go back and think about the relationship that the angles of a rhombus have. How does angle B, the entire angle B, relate to angle A? How does all of angle B relate to all of angle A? Don't break it up. Calvin? They're supplementary. So can I figure out what the measure of angle B is? How do I do it, Caleb?
Well, I think... So you have part of it already. You already have 58 degrees.
Now what part of it is that? Remembering this theorem... Traveler?
I think the other half of B would be 58 also.
Because this is a diagonal, DB's a diagonal, Straveler's identified that this angle will be congruent to this angle. So angle B together has to be double that size, which is going to be 116.
And then you can solve for A.
Which means that angle A must be its supplement. So what's the supplement? 64, which then means that angle 4 is half of that, which is 32. Is anyone confused with how we got there? It's like, as soon as we know this, we know that, we know that, we know that, we know that. Like, it just, yeah, it sets up this big old chain reaction. And this is why a lot of times I say, like, I'm in love with math, and math is beautiful, and all these things, because... Like, literally, yeah, Scarlett's like, oh, you're in love with math? Take it to a movie. No, but so, like, as soon as I figure out one piece of information, it just sets off this reaction of things that I can figure out, and it's just awesome. Shaw, what else can we figure out? B has to be congruent to D because opposite angles at the corner are congruent. So angle D, then... I don't know where to put things. I wish it would block it together. So then we know angle D is the same as angle B, which makes it 116. So then angle 2 and angle 3.
There's actually an easier way that we could have done that.
I agree with what you said, and it's right. But if I look at this angle right here and this angle right here, what relationship do they have?
Karma? Yeah, alternate interior angles.
But yeah, so if we look at these two parallel lines and BD is my transversal, these are alternate interiors. They have to be congruent, so I know angle 2 has to be 58 and angle 3 also has to be 50. I didn't even need to figure out angle D to get there.
Yeah.
Ooh, angle 1 is 90 because the diagonals are perpendicular, and we know this because why?
Because it's a rhombus. Well, and a rhombus.
It says in theorem 50,
right. Another way we can prove this, because if you were asked to do this in a proof, which you very well, we what? Yeah. So, if you haven't done last night's homework, you're asked to prove this. But another way we can do this, Ethan?
Triangle sum theorem.
We know it. We've proved the triangle angle sum theorem. We did that at the end of that mastery. So now that we have proven that, we're able to use it.
So by triangle angle sum theorem, I know that 1, 3, and 4 will add up to 180. Well, I know 4 is 32. 3 is 58. Those, when added up, make 90, yes. Which leaves that angle 1 has to be the remaining 90 degrees.
Any questions there? It's purdy.
Never heard of that.
P-U-R-D-Y?
I've heard of
Purdy's that. Actually a company, too. They make, like, work
isn't
things.
Isn't that, like, what older people used to say?
Yeah, things are purdy.
Yeah.
So, I have a question for you. I have a question for you posed by my grandpa. Sorry, I just thought that this would be a good group to give that question to, and then we'll get back to the business. How do you say the thing that some of you ride to school?
A bike.
Well, a full name.
Bicycle,
right? How do you say it when you have to have a license to drive it, but it's the same basic thing, essentially?
Motorcycle.
Motorcycle, right? Why do we say motorcycle and bicycle? Sickle versus cycle. Why does that happen?
Sounds better.
Why does motor?
That's just because you're used to saying it's
a song.
So I know. Refrigerator. I know. And actually, fridge and refrigerator has a D in the word fridge. F-R-I-D-G. Right? Yeah, but there's a D. You were asking about the D, right? Or the T? Or okay, never mind. But, so, I thought that was really interesting, because it's like, why do we do these things? You guys should be able to do this on your own. There are a few ways that we can do it. So, take 45 seconds. Solve out these four angles.
Where's the sign-up
sheet? On the podium in the hallway. Remember, we're in the pod.
I thought you were like the 8th grade teachers,
they have their own separate. So
these are all just observations. Not that these are required to solve this, but just things that hopefully you immediately identify when you look at this. and this is why we do so much work with parallel lines and transversals, is when I see the alternate interior angles, 1, 4, or 3, 2, those have to be congruent with each other. And since 1 has to be congruent to 4, 3 has to be congruent to 2, and I know that the diagonal does what?
Bisect.
The diagonal bisecting then tells me that angle 3 has to be congruent to angle 4, and also angle 1 has to be congruent to angle 2. So really, what? Say it louder. They're all going to be congruent to each other. So, how do we do this? What, like, there are different routes. So really my question is, how did you do this? I need to make cards so I can keep track of who did what. Carmen, and I'll cycle back to you guys keep having the same hands up, so.
I did 180 minus 104, and I got
76. Yeah, so, now one thing that I forgot to write up here that's just interesting to look at, this is based off triangle angle sum theorem. I could also say angle 1 plus angle 2 plus 104 equals 180, because they are supplementary.
That's kind of how I
did. Yeah, so that's why I wrote that up there, because that's essentially what you did, was paired up the supplementary. But at first, you looked at these as an angle.
Yeah.
So you got that angle, the sum of those was how much?
76.
So then we divide it by 2, and we get that angle 1 or 2
equals 47. Oh, no. It's, what did I say?
47. Cut the 70 in half, you get 35. Cut the 3 in half, or cut the 6 in half, you get 3. 38, which means that all of my angles are all 38 degrees because they're all congruent to each other. Are there any questions how we do this? There's really only ever going to be two different angles. If you have both diagonals and all of the angles bisect and stuff, there's really only ever going to be two different angle sizes. And guys, that was back in our rhombus theorem, if this ever captures, so I can go back up. Notice how these are all blue and these are all red. There's only really two different sizes of angles here. If you look at these together, there's the big red and then big blue, or if you look at them broken up, there's the little red, little blue.
My friend's mom made her car blue.
I named my first Honda Torino. So, in rectangle, RSBF, SF is 2x plus 15. And RB is 5x minus 12. What relationship exists here? If we're looking at rectangles and we're dealing with the diagonals. Calvin?
The diagonals are congruent.
They must be congruent to each other. So I can take my 2x plus 15 and set that equal to my 5x minus 12. Now you have options. You really have four options to start this process. One of them will be easier than the others. What's the easiest way to start this process? Traveler?
Add 12 to
the side. Yeah, if I want to make things positive, so my two best options would be either what Traveler said, the add 12 to both sides. Or, yeah, I look at the variables, and I like to make my variables positive. So I'd say which side has the bigger variable term, and take the variable off the other side. Now here's the part that I'm concerned to say, but I think you guys can handle this. I can do an operation with a constant and an operation with a variable at the same time, as long as I keep my work straight. So, my variables disappear. My constants become 27. My variables become 3x. My constants disappear.
So in one step, I can get my variables together and my constants together. You have a confused look. Question? Yeah, Emma. Okay, well, you just had a look on your face. Maybe it was the look of, yeah, you think this is new? I mean, it could be that look. So what's not new, just in seventh grade, well, I wasn't your seventh grade teacher, but in seventh grade, we don't really tell kids to do that because it's too much work at one time. And they like to then get things jumbled up and they just make mistakes. So at this level, though, you guys are obviously a little bit more advanced. You guys, fine to do that. If you have color, that can help keep things straight as well. Last thing to do to solve, Michelle?
Divide by 3, which gives me an x value of
9.
We are not done.
Be careful with problems like this. You are not done because you've not answered the question. Question is, what's the length of the diagonal?
So we need to take our variable, plug it into one of these locations,
and they should come out to be equal. Straveler?
I think it is 33.
You think or no?
I know it's 33.
You know it's 33? So 5 times 9, 45 minus 12 gives me 33. 2 times 9, 18 plus 15 gives me 33. Any questions? All right, try this one on your own. Same basic process. I just want to make sure that you are not too rusty at this.
So my goal is to make up a little bit of time tomorrow, maybe make up a little bit more, or make up a little bit of time today, maybe a little bit more tomorrow, and hopefully Friday we have plenty of time during class to do homework that you wouldn't really have homework to take home. So that would be my goal. I'm fine to assign homework on a Friday. I don't like you having to take it all home. And even then it won't be due until Tuesday. So. Because it's already up. I posted everything for the week, and I'm going to put a picture on the PTSA Facebook group because I'm trying to keep parents informed. But yeah, know that Friday homework is never due until Tuesday, so you don't actually have to spend your weekend doing it if you choose not to. What did we get for the length of x? Yeah, Brian?
I had a question, but the length of x?
Or the value of x, I guess.
The value is 15.
Anyone verify?
Yes.
Yep. So then the length of your diagonals?
43.
So then your question?
Oh, when's the mastery?
Probably next Friday. I like to put masteries on Fridays to just have no homework and so you guys can kind of like have the week to get ready. So we'll start chapter 6 before we take this mastery. So it gives you more time if you need to get that practice work done or review anything or work with me. And then we try to do it on Fridays. Cool. So let's move on to the next note set. Of conditions for rhombuses, rectangles, and squares. So we are still talking about the same shapes, rhombuses, rectangles, squares. Now just looking at them slightly different. So what we see is if ABCD is a parallelogram and my diagonals meet at a 90 degree angle, it's a rhombus. Well, we already knew that a rhombus had those qualifications, but this is kind of working the other way around. If I see a shape, I determine it's a parallelogram, and then I determine the diagonals are perpendicular, then I can tell it's a rhombus, as opposed to being told something's a rhombus and working from there. Does that make sense? We've kind of turned the process around. So, theorem 54 states if I have a parallelogram and my diagonals bisect the angles, then it's a rhombus. So another property of a rhombus. Do I need to prove both? Do I need to prove that my diagonals are perpendicular and that they bisect the angles? No. Why?
Because if one says that if you find that, it proves the rhombus.
Yeah.
Then if you find that, it proves the rhombus.
Yep. So, if I have found this,
this is going to happen. If I have found this, that is going to happen. So we do not need to prove both. We only need to prove one of them. Then if the diagonals of a parallelogram are congruent to each other. Sorry, I'm ahead of myself, I think. No, yeah. If they are congruent, it just doesn't show the marks because it's kind of hard to show when they hit each other in the middle. So if AC is congruent to BD, we know that it then becomes a rectangle. Could it be a square?
Yes.
So be careful. If it asks for the most specific classification, rectangle may not be most specific. You then want to look at, can I determine anything about the side lengths? If I can determine that they're even or congruent, then I know that it is also a square. So, based off what we see here, we are told that it's a parallelogram. So that's step one. It's got to be a parallelogram. What do I observe in A? Is it enough to prove that it is a rhombus, rectangle, or square? Calvin?
You can at least prove that it's a rhombus because the diagonal by it is 60.
So, because, and you don't necessarily have to write this, but because of diagonal bisector, I'm going to say diagonal angle bisector, this is a rhombus. Now I'm going to break down B a little bit more. The first thing I see is its diagonals are perpendicular. It's the first thing I see. What does perpendicular diagonals tell me?
That the diagonal lengths are the same.
No. Because like in a kite, my... So this tells me rhombus. Perpendicular... diagonals tell me rhombus. Then, because we're not done, then I notice the diagonals are congruent with each other and they bisect each other. And they meet at a right angle. So what do the diagonals being congruent, that's when your brain getting ahead of itself, what does that tell us? Brian?
Square.
Now, wait, I don't know my side lengths, though. How do you know? You can't say it's a square because it's a square.
But if the diagonals are congruent, then it has to be a square, doesn't it?
But the diagonals of a rectangle are congruent.
Oh, but it's a rectangle.
Ah, so because I've created, essentially, congruent triangles. Side, angle, side. I've essentially created congruent triangles. This then tells me that these are all congruent to each other. And from there, I know it's a square, which is also a rhombus, which is also a rectangle. So this really is all of them, but square is your most specific classification. So that is what we would land on.
Okay. Because it's a rhombus and a rectangle, does that make it a square?
Well.
A rectombus?
If we go back right here, a rhombus that is a rectangle, is there anything else that is a rhombus and a rectangle? No. So, what I was trying to get us to get to, this learning target should be up here. What I was trying to get to is the fact that the perpendicular diagonals tell me rhombus. The congruent diagonals tell me rectangle because it's both. It has to be a square. But then I just like messing with Brian, so that's why I said, well, how do we know? So, but I want you to realize it creates congruent triangles based off side, angle, side, and that is going to be important as we work through and solve different problems using these things. Hey, we might get through all of this. Parallelogram has angle measures of 20, 160, 20, and 160. Can you conclude that it is a rhombus, rectangle, or square. What do you think, Calvin?
No!
We can't conclude anything about it?
No.
Why not?
Because opposite angle measures being congruent is just means that it's a parallelogram.
Yeah, so the angles verify that it's a parallelogram, which that's a bad parallelogram. And nothing else. Knowing only the angles tells me nothing aside from the fact that it's a parallelogram. So there's always an example and then a got it. So a lot of times we do the example together and then you guys do the got it and I just kind of meander around and check. But because we're still getting used to stuff and trying to fly through this quickly, we're just kind of doing all of this together. So for problem two, while this finishes capturing and having a moment, use the properties of special parallelograms. So we know this is a parallelogram. For what value of x makes this a rhombus? So in order for this to be a rhombus, think about the fact, and I sometimes just tell you, but I wanted this to be notated here. Think about the fact that diagonals must bisect the angle. So to make this be a rhombus, what can we do? I know you know it. Carmen?
Then 6x minus 2 equals 4.
Yeah, I have to set these equal because they have to be bisected by the diagonal. So, 6x minus 2, 4x plus 8. Again, as Emma smiles slyly, thinking I've done this for a long time.
No.
Ah. Get your constants together. Get your variables together on different sides. We end up with 2x equal to 10. And that means that the value of x must be
5.
Very good. Muy bien. I keep like getting what you keep hearing my voice like crack whatever.
No, I was saying muy bien as you go muy bien, and it was very crazy.
I'm fighting with some allergies, so if my voice sounds weird, I can't breathe at night. It's not great.
What?
Not I can't breathe, but I'm all congested and stuff. It's every time the season changes, my allergies just flare way up.
My allergies flare way up.
So, we only got a couple minutes left, guys. For what value of y is DEFG a rectangle? Caleb?
Well, if you know it's going to be a rectangle, then the diagonal is going to be congruent. So, if you want to prove that, you have to have 5y plus 3 equals y minus 5. And with some math, it's just
4. With some math. Yeah. Everyone agree?
Yeah.
With a little bit of math, we subtract 5y from both sides, add 5 to both sides, we get that 2y is equal to 8, and then y is 4.
We can do it.
So, let's say that we're building something. We build lots of things at my house. So builders use properties of diagonals to square up. What's it mean to square up, Brian? Yeah, make a right angle. So, rectangular shapes like building frames and playing field boundaries. So, we've done this on my landscaping crew. This actually happens when you have lengths of rope or things that are the same length. It's much easier than trying to actually make a 90 degree angle. Because when you're like in somebody's yard that is sloped and things are like changing and all, like, it's very hard to work with specific angles. But if you just take two lengths of rope that are the exact same length, and you can actually just like fold them over in the middle and find their midpoints, and then we would tie that around a stake. Then if you stretch it out, so you put the stake in the middle, like a spike, not like, you know, a T-bone. So, you're helping lay out a rectangular patio for the youth center. How can you use properties of diagonals to locate the four corners? So, all we would need to do is lay out the rope. And then, what else needs to happen if I want to make sure it's rectangular? Does rectangular have anything else specific in it that we care about? Yeah, so if I know that I'm going to connect these two points, like the end points are going to be connected. So my question really is, what if this person comes this way and then that person comes that way? Like, what if they moved? Would that still be a rectangle as long as they pull it straight and tight? Yeah, the length and widths could change, but it would still be a rectangle because the main property of rectangle is that the diagonals have to be congruent. So once you do this, you know you have a rectangle, assuming your ropes are actually the same length. So we could do the problem three, got it, but I think we all understand it. So that will be our wrap for today. Do your homework as you have time. We will do the 5-6 lesson tomorrow, and then you will have a work day on Friday, probably.
Sweet man.
Sweet man cool.
I was thinking of the other one.